Before I hand over to family moderators, Pete Heveland, Edoa, and Matthew Elenu, got that one, so 50%. Matthew Elenu, my name is Yazier Henry, I teach at the school, and I welcome you all, those of you from the school and those of you joining us. What I want to do very quickly is just frame this process, the panel, and the ground rules, and then hand over to Matt and Pete. I am experimenting with different forms of dialogic processes so that we can deepen some of this very difficult and important conversations that are taking place in the world and at our school and at our university. Therefore, we've structured this process very tightly but completely openly. I want to thank those of you that came, that agreed to join us, secondly, moderator respondents, and those of you that are in the second and third and fourth tier rows will realize there's a complete circle of amazing human beings here, and will be glad to participate together with myself, and I'd like to welcome Troy Harden from Chicago and Northeastern Illinois University. So, what we're going to do is we're going to run through a very quick process so that we can get to a broader moment and engage not only with ourselves but with you as members of the Ford School and the university and the broader community as well. There are really two simple ground rules for today. The first one is do not harm anyone. The second one is think about what you are going to say. And the third one is when you listen to whatever is being said, listen as far as it is possible non-violently. It is our effort and attempt to develop a space here at the Ford School in which we can have hard and difficult conversations, which hopefully will inspire further conversations that honors and recognizes the privilege of and safety of the space that we can hold as intellectuals, as thinkers, and future leadership resources of the world. Now, developing and creating and opening a space like this has taken a year. I want to mark that. And this probably will take several years more to consolidate as part of our DNA here at the Ford School. We can achieve and make that space possible only through you and through our collective engagement with each other as intellectuals, as thinkers, and people who care about the world, even its pain. And this is what we are working with inside of the structure right now. For me. There are several timekeepers in the room that will, when time is over for whoever speaking, including me, please, including me, raise up their time sheets. Thank you. Yeah? And they will do so silently. And when all these time sheets are up, please conclude your thoughts and your speech. Give the moderators a chance to move us further inside of the conversation. Okay. Now, I will say so now. I am fully aware that the conversation that we hold today will be as complete as the time allows it, and it will always already be incomplete. That is not my aim, or our aim when we create the space to solve everything right now. It is to actually have that important dialogue that hopefully will produce itself in such ways in which it does affect the possibility of an engagement with issues as they affect society, not only here where I stand, but at the nether end of the earth where I come from and was born. So I'm going to hand over a minute early, which is not usual for me, to Pete and Matt. I think I've said enough.
Me and Pete decided that since my paper's longer, I'll be the enforcer for the this engagement. Just to first reiterate what Yazier tried and did convey, is that this is not meant to be a performance or an exhibition. We're talking about real problems, real things that affect real people. And so with that, you know, the goal is not to fix anything, to solve anything, but to talk about these things. And talk about them in the way that you feel, not the way that you think is right. You know, accept your own opinion, your feelings, and convey what you feel and from the heart. Also, I know we're all grad students and I see some PhDs in the room. You know, definitely make sure we're saying things clearly, coherently. Try to keep the words below six syllables, if you can. I know it's hard for some of us, but you know, the goal is to have a good conversation, rich in dialogue, not rich in performance. And so please come prepared to talk, you know, from your heart and your soul, as well as your intellect. But with that, I'll introduce myself a bit more. In terms of how I'm kind of related, I've known Yazier for several years as a student, and though I'm not directly related to the systemic violence in the way that they talk about in terms of public space, you know, I'm more in terms of research in the home and absent fatherhood, and the way in which fathers are becoming an aberration in the home. And that is my contribution, and I'll pass it over to you.
Thanks, Matt. So I'll start off by introducing myself. My name is Pete Haviland-Adewa. I'm a second year MPP student here at the Ford School, originally from upstate New York. And I guess that I'm connected with the topics that we're here discussing today, both within my own lived experience and as well as activist activities, as I guess you could call them. I'm not sure that I would necessarily refer them as that, especially over the past 2 years. I think I've always been passionate about communities of color and how systemic racism and oppression affects them, but I think I was activated when Trayvon Martin was shot and killed, and then I think that activation turned into a fire when I saw Mike Brown lying in the street in August of 2014. And so since 2014, I've been working with the Million Hoodies Movement for Justice in a policy position, working to end marginalization, criminalization, and stigmatization of communities of color domestically. Been protesting here in Ann Arbor, protested and marched in New York City, been around the country talking about these issues, working these out with other people that are passionate about this, and so I'm very happy to be with folks here today. And just to build on some of the ground rules that Matt had mentioned, how this is going to work is Yazier and Troy are going to give some remarks shortly. And then after that, we've selected 12 co-moderators, which are in the space today, which I believe most of you are sitting in the lower circle here. And you will have 2 minutes each. 2 minutes each to respond and give thoughts. And then we're going to have a little bit more time for a discussion. We're going to give Troy and Yazier an opportunity to respond to your thoughts. And then we're going to open it up to the rest of the audience after that to have an opportunity to speak. So everyone, I hope, will have an opportunity to speak that has something to say. And so we're looking forward to this discussion. So thank you.
And also, I've got to introduce myself. I'm Matthew, a fourth-year PhD student in the Department of Sociology and Public Policy. I also wanted to offer the seat in case anybody's dying to sit down. I'm going to stand for duration, so if anyone wants it, feel free to come and take it up just to the side so you can do it properly.
Thank you.
just want to acknowledge, thank you, Jim Collins, for joining us. This was the seat just for you, if you wish, like, if you wish to take it. We thought you were going to slip in quietly, I'm sorry. So just before I start now, I was a minute early, so it looks like I'm going to take the minute back. Jim Collins, thank you for joining us. And I want to acknowledge Dean Collins for encouraging and making the type of space that we're trying to create here to discuss these difficult issues possible. Those of you who have programs, there's an abstract in the program. It is just that, an abstract, very broad. I spent many hours trying to make it very broad so that we can engage it. I'm going to speak to the South African possibility and do so abstractly. If I'm speaking too slowly sitting here, just tell me. South Africa, where I was born, is a violent place. But it is more than that. And the more than that is what I want to come to. But before I do so, I want to say it has always been violent. Now, I'm not just an academic and an intellectual and someone engaged with these issues in the world, but I'm also a survivor. From a context in which most of the men who live there live harsh lives. Violent at worst, as violence on and against the body, and violence as best, economically, as internalized and psychically embodied. This experience, expression, and iteration of violent life as collective and group experience is, I want to argue, as part of this conversation, a political experience. It is not simply the result of being male, of being poor, of being administratively and socio-legally colored as less than human, in soft terms. But in harsher terms, it is also direct and lived as legacy. I and we, those defined and colored in this way, are not in essence violent beings. No single category of identity is comprehensible outside of the language that describes, inscribes, and circumscribes such identity categories in relation to and in relation with categories that are validated, valorized, and imbued with a counter essence, what I would call here an essentialism of the ideal category, the modern, the civil, the civic, the less violent, the peaceful, the not barbaric category. The violence I speak here exists then in and across the structural, the political, the economic, the psychological categorization of identity, and in and through historical and political domains and spheres of the systemic. Structure and policy coagulated as life. Systemic then, as endemic, as interpretive, and epistemic, as everywhere and all the time. Still, it is not pure, nor can it be purifying. This violence. I must move a little bit forward, because each time Troy does that, I think it's the time sign. Sorry, no, it's fine. It is not this violence conceptually and intellectually, materially and morally, the same type, the same feeling, the same expression, or the same deployment of force. It is textured and contextured, and this afternoon I may have created this word, please correct me if I attributing it incorrectly to myself, contextured, and it can be verified, please don't hesitate, into how human beings who share administrative, legal, and social space understand, see, view, and speak themselves into the political world of policy life, of social life, and of economic life. This violence then lives its ensuing pain, its ensuing trauma, as daily and as all the time. There is no freedom from violence, only distance to and proximity from, as related to a violent external expression and deployment and experience of force as the legacy and the lived experience in the present of pain and trauma, thus as extra psychic life. Therefore, the violence I'm conceiving of here intellectually and politically, taking responsibility to name and apprehend and engage as dialogue, is also the violence of what I call the meta-concept, or what for me is the meta-concept, one, and two, the legal and the political construct of this meta-concept, and three, the administrative and the managerial construct of this concept, and four, the moral and the social life of this construct of identity, of violent identity, of violent looking, of violent living, of violent seeing, of violent being, and of violent recovery. For South African men who are colored legally as non-white, this has devastating gendered consequences, not only for those men, but for their families, their communities, the women who live in such communities, and the children who are forced to live through such community. So while the violence is alarming, it is not altogether coincidental. It is simultaneously expressed at, across and through this conceptual iteration and construction of identity as socially linked and lived socio-spatially at the same time, but not in the same place. So, I will conclude my opening remarks and emphasize that it's just that, opening remarks to a conversation. The approach taken sometimes in a number of common and mainstream sources serves then to essentialize the color black, the color brown, the color red, as associated gendered experience of black men who are violent. I hope that I sit here as living proof and experience that it is an interpretive category, not a truth.
All right, thank you, thank you. Thank you. First, I'd like to just acknowledge the Dean Collins, as well as the Gerald R. Ford School of Public Policy for creating this space. It's an important conversation. I think this conversation has national as well as global implications. And the continued conversation around this space. So I think it's important and bold to be able to have it. And I also want to acknowledge Matt. Thank you for hosting the space and for your work and our conversation around absence. Because I think inherent within this larger conversation of violence is this point of absence, who's not present versus who is. And what stories get told within that narrative, right? And thank you, Pete, as well, for your work. And you reminded me that it doesn't matter when you enter and when you become active in struggle. The point is that when you hit that moment of truth, that you go from there, right? And so I start there with this conversation is that we are in a critical moment in history where a lot of moments of truth are rising, right? With Trayvon, with Michael Brown, with Eric Garner, with Tamir Rice, with Laquan McDonald, right? We had a new moment of truth in Chicago recently with Laquan McDonald, where there was a reckoning and continues to be a reckoning around the impact of that structural violence that takes place on a regular basis, right? So that's important to acknowledge those moments of truth and that reckoning, because I think any conversation that we invite around this work, but first let me just say this. So my work has been, over the last few years, really lifting up and thinking about what it means to be trauma-informed. And much of that discussion focuses on interpersonal violence, you know, things that are happening within the home, or even some of the impact of the community violence that we see in the streets, right? And so as a social worker by trade and somebody who teaches in the social work profession, you know, we often talk about what does it mean for a practitioner to be trauma-informed in his or her work, what does a trauma-informed school look like, what's a trauma-informed health clinic, et cetera. And what I've been positioning is that that's important and needed and critical, but it falls short of the institutional framework because we understand and acknowledge what happens when an individual fails, but what happens when an institution fails, right? And what happens when that institution has a legacy and a history and of failing and of establishing mistrust? And when the people are in it who are good people, people who have been trained, people who are doing good work, people who are well-intended, even within that system, you know, what happens when that system still fails, right? So I think I mentioned a little bit yesterday, I sat in a circle with a group of cops, police, Chicago police officers, and some young people a few months ago. And it was 2 days before the Laquan McDonald announcement was getting ready to happen. And we were talking about police and community relationships, and they were very worried. And they were worried and anxious because of this announcement, what would happen. And they were also personally worried because they were tired of being linked to bad cops. They were tired of the narrative because they were good cops, they do youth work, they do stand-up work, and so what would happen when this announcement came out? And they would be caught in that narrative. And so I acknowledge first their work and their hearts and even why they might have entered the profession. But then I ask the question, what do you do when you see bad cops? What do you do within the institution? And they grew silent. They didn't say anything. They kind of just shrugged. And they talked a little bit about the code of blue and how difficult it was to be able to say something and things like that, right? So I invoke King calling on Nitschke, right? You know, the greatest evil in the world is not done by evil people doing bad things. It's by good people who see it and do nothing about it. So I argue that violence and structural violence takes place every day in those moments. And those opportunities exist all the time for us to say something and do something, and we don't do it. So there I enter the trauma conversation with, as Yazier said, with a historical lens, a lens that invites both resistance and resilience in the face of trauma. There's a history of terrible things happening in communities of color, you know, since the beginning of this country. And coupled with that, there's always been resistance. And with that, I don't diminish victim and what it means to be victim within the context of that space, but I invite a new framing around how we might see victim into a serious conversation that invites the presence and possibilities of restoration and restorative accountability, you know, within that space. So I think we ask the question of whose voice is absent, who's not present, and how that might contribute to both objectification and the continued violence that persists, and then how we might create that inclusive community and that serious conversation of truth where in those moments of truth we can then create that transformative justice framework. So I'll stop there.
So thank you both, and I think that there was a lot that came up to me when the two of you were talking, and I think the concept of violence and the many different forms that it's taking is something that is relatively new to my intellectual process and how I think about structural racism and structural oppression. And I think about the way that this type of violence impacted me as an individual in my psychological development as a black man from a predominantly white community. And it's things that happened that I didn't even realize. You know, for example, it was always projected upon me that as a black person, I was expected to fail growing up. And within my own home, that was debunked. But my peers, my classmates, expected me to do poorly in school, expected me to be good at sports, and when I fell outside of those norms, I was outcast as another. And that in turn pushed myself and people around me to have this internalized depression. And I saw some other black men that I grew up with take this, and they really took it to heart. And it was to the point where I had a football teammate, and we were talking about grades that we had recently got in high school. And when he found out I had done well, he told me that I was white. And that, to me, it was a trigger. And I went off, and I went at him with physical violence because I was so angry, because I didn't know how to deal with his oppression. I didn't know how to deal with his violence as a 17-year-old. And it took four teammates to pull me off of him. But these are the types of things that we have to deal with. And I know that many of us, we had this a very difficult conversation last year when some of my colleagues here at the Policy School, we put together Walking the Line of Blackness. And we talked about our experience as black students in the public policy sphere and how isolating that can be because there's violence around us every day. And so when the two of you were talking, that really resonated with me. And I think that that's something I'd like to hear more about is the different forms of violence that we encounter on a day-to-day basis and how we can combat them. Mm-hmm.
So a few things stood out to me that crosses both of what you both touched on. Yazier, you mentioned something about, you mentioned like a meta narrative and identity formation. You know, and thinking about the specific instances you talk about, Troy, what can we say and think about in terms of the way in which, you know, systemic and structural violence and marginalization impacts the way that identity is formed and the way it's imposed? And by that I mean, you know, what does it say for, you know, a young black man to grow up in an all-black environment that's said to be violent? You know, how can he construct identity in light of all these kind of structural impositions? Just the same, you know, what can be said and how can we talk more about the way in which we impose meaning from external representations on communities, right? So how many times have we all said, oh, an area's rough, or it's bad, or it's not safe, right? And what does that mean when we make blanket statements about spaces regarding people we don't even know, such that you can see Trayvon Martin with a hoodie and have an automatic idea of what he means, right? That no matter the context, that these kind of meta-narratives affect us in our day-to-day and affects the way we think about ourselves, but also the way people think about us in ways we can't control. And how can we talk more about that kind of nexus between the imposition of identity and the kind of self-realization of identity in terms of violence?
Will you respond now?
Yes.
Oh, awesome. When I heard and listened to you, I was thinking about something, you know, I mentioned in the references yesterday, this idea of injury, right? That these injuries occur in a certain context. In a simplified version, that could certainly, as someone who went off to college and came back home, and little nuances in my vernacular changed. I started using some of those six-syllable words a little bit more, right? And there's nothing wrong with a few six-syllable words, right? As long as we also are authentic, right?
Right.
That I was also told I was talking white, my family, and what that did. But I also put that in context, which is in a larger issue around the politic of trust, right? Because what my family really want to know, what my friends really want to know, is could I still be trusted? You know, which goes back to a history of people who have often betrayed the community at the expense of white power and white privilege, right? So with that being said, then it was my obligation to respond in a different way. Now, I'm not saying I did that when I was 18, 19, you know, but as I've matured and grown, I've realized that that context looms, and those microaggressions that you referenced that happen every day in the hallway, they continue to happen. And they continue to happen within the politics of race, both interrace as well as interracially, right? It happens both within the race and outside the race. And so how we move beyond that, I think, is a part of the larger conversation. So I'll stop there. And I just want to say one thing, too, that I referenced the police, because I think we see the injury that happens for the people in the community, but also those cops were injured as well by that experience. They often enter into that profession, particularly coming from the community, you know, as trying to be an other, trying to be something different. And yet they experience that. I would offer even some of the white cops experience that as well. Much like the concept of moral injury that comes through the military, where people go off and they're going to serve the country and then end up feeling like they've been betrayed, both by the institution, often sometimes by the government, and even themselves, their own moral ethic. And they come back and they can't resolve that. I offer that injury goes a lot of different ways. It just doesn't go to the other, right? Or those who are oppressed, it also engages the oppressor as well.
Me, to engage the points that I've laid out in terms of a lived meta-narrative of violence. Whenever I've spoken and iterated the word violence today, each time I've at the same time iterated its opposite. Although I don't think it's spoken. And for me, understanding the relationship between the creation of space that allows for violent life is also understanding the possibility of creating space that allows for a more peaceful life. And this is, for me, in essence, the idea of restorative accountability, which is in the title. Now, many people speak of restorative justice, and oftentimes it's related and located very, very specifically in a narrow intellectual construct related to criminal justice. So for me, restorative accountability sits inside of the person as well. I mean, I, as a survivor of a context where most men in my community don't necessarily live beyond the age of 40. That, just because that is true, doesn't mean I'm not accountable as a human being, as a person, to survive, and to survive in a way that acknowledges, apprehends the structure of violence, how it lives as an individual. So this is why it's become my life work. I mean, it's why I studied violence and structure, because it lived with me from before I was born in a country that was legally called a crime against humanity before I was born. So that's for me, you know, who this idea of restorative accountability, who escapes accountability, as Troy mentioned, what is absent in our dialogue? Yeah. Who is absent and why? And how do we bring that possibility, that structure in as leaders, as resources, when the dominant narrative, the meta-narrative that I'm relating to socioeconomically, and in my country, for example, South Africa is still constructed in relationship to an ideal of what it is to be a successful white man. So the construction of blackness and the construction of brownness, the construction of any otherness is always a relational construction. And as long as this construction of identity remains rooted in South Africa, for example, in the legacy of colonization and of apartheid, where men, black and white, feel entitled in the validation of their power. And if I do not, as a man identified by others, interrupt intellectually. When he was 17, 14 people interrupted that moment. Yeah? Not so many men are, or many people who commit that are that lucky and end up in hands of, of the criminal justice system. My responsibility is to interrupt that in every moment of my life. And then as a black man, as someone identified as other, I carry that as an extraordinary burden.
So thank you both. And with that, I think we want to give our secondary moderators an opportunity to say a few words. It doesn't necessarily have to be a question. It can be a comment, just how you're feeling, where you're at, but just some words. I will leave it up to you to decide who goes first and you can navigate that using your voices.
I am ready. Some of us were able yesterday to hear Troy speak about some, in a short time of listening to you present, I've decided that I'd like to call you by your first name. Please be on the vigilant for this moment. He spoke about some programs that utilize a trauma-informed lens, and they have succeeded in really reducing recidivism rates for young men. In fact, in one of the stories he told us, there was only one incidence of recidivism, and that young man could be called the failure of the program. However, by telling his story, Troy honored the young man's path, his strength and worth, and his value in his community. And you made it easy to listen, as Yazier has asked us to do, nonviolently. Even the title of this discussion includes some very powerful words that bring men into the conversation about healing. I, as a female, observe often that men, particularly men of color, who have perpetrated violence, that at that act of perpetration, they are socially diminished. Their lifelong role and identity as a survivor, as Yazier said, someone is accountable as a human to survive, that's stripped from them. As they survive systemic and interpersonal violence. Their complex life becomes a one-dimensional characteristic, or character that becomes ready for us as a public viewer consumption. It's one-dimensional character, this violent perpetrator. So I have a few questions that you can ask or simply ponder, or that you can answer or simply ponder. First, is there anything else that you'd like to share that would help us to foster a more multidimensional interpretation or appreciation of human beings? Secondly, what does the role of survivors turned perpetrator, do they play a role in restorative accountability? And finally, the word gender has almost become nomenclature for female or otherwise non-male genders. So I invite you to expand on your choice to address gender. What I'm now seeing as a new interpretation of gender-based violence in this discussion.
There's no order, so whoever wants to go next, feel free to speak.
I can go. I'd like to touch a little bit on what you mentioned about the imposition of identity and realization of identity. And what stood out to me out of the discussion was when Dr. Harden said that we are at a critical moment in history. And what I took that to mean is that we're both at a time, like you mentioned, that there's this increased violence against men of color. But I also took it to, you know, I see that thanks to where we are now at this moment, that we're able to be very aware of the situation, right? And that we're all very aware of what is wrong within systems and maybe, you know, what we can do about it. So that's, you know, where we are and like also how far we've come. And also touch upon Pete's comment that there is this expectation to fail for men of color. And I just think that, to me, what stood out that we're at such a critical point in time is that as students, particularly graduate students at such a prestigious program, and like we've come through and overcome many hurdles most of this time, so we've been able to identify the sources of oppression. And if we're able to identify them, I think we should be able to enact it on avoiding them and being active within ourselves to know what we've accomplished. So to me, I'd like to just get some comments from you on like what you think, if you find it problematic that sometimes students of color try to take on this role of oppression that is experienced in marginalized communities, but is not necessarily experienced within the university, and what message that sends to someone who actually experiences systemic violence.
I can go. So 12 years ago, I was getting my bachelor's in history and a focus on women's studies, and I was sitting in the classes, and I also wanted to realize that there's no African-American women in these classes, and I wondered why was that the case, and so I focused my history graduation thesis on racism within the women's studies movement, or within the women's rights movement. So 12 years down the road now, I'm having these conversations with loved ones and friends and acquaintances, and having to also reflect that the narrative and the historical story was also in me, and then this perspective as wanting to make a singular oppressor, that the white man is the oppressor and all others are the victims, and allowing ourselves to take on the role as a victim. And then, and secondary to that is also this idea that, well, the problem's been fixed. We've had the civil rights movement has happened, and there's policy in place that has reversed the issue. So therefore, you know, this is only an issue of one bad cop. This is an issue of that particular person almost being deserving of the punishment of his actions. So I don't know. I don't even know if this is necessarily something that could be answered in this question in this sphere, but I guess my thoughts on this was talking about restorative accountability, that violent recovery. What does it look like within my demographic for that process to happen?
I'll go next. So first, just want to start off to say that I am from a poverty-stricken neighborhood, yet even though I'm not proud of that, I am still proud of the survival. So thank you, Yazier, for bringing that to light, because I too am proud of that. And in America, racism is a default setting. To do nothing, to go along with the market, to claim innocence or neutrality, it is inevitably to be a cog in a machine of racist hierarchy. The policymakers and the activists that ignore the intersectionality of progressiveness are the heirs to this history. Not personal racists, but cogs in a machine that is working just fine. Restorative justice and the work thereof is historic and heroic innovator, trying to go past the engines and the screws that hold such institutions discussed today together, reaching for the cogs to see when it can shut down the systematic oppression the quickest. As for policy students, we are walking into the world once as an innovator, as a heroine, but leaving as another cog in the machine. Our communities, my communities, are failing, and what are we doing about it? Restoring the historical trauma placed on the poor that is constantly charged guilty until proven poor again. It's a strategy that can be used to bless the communities that are suffering. But my question is, with what resources can we restore such a people? If millionaires wanted to solve this issue, wouldn't it be solved? The machine would have been broken. Plenty we see the poor helping the poor. Can we ask the heteronormatives, white, wealthy brothers, are they ready to consciously help this movement without being the saving grace? How can we strategically and facilitate the dialogue and discussion without violence? We have started, we have researched, but now, do we have the genuine power to restore the souls of the lost and broken while the machine is still working just fine to produce historical oppression in poor communities, both in South Africa and the U.S.?
So I would like to give an example of that machine working just fine in South Africa. Given our exceedingly violent history and how it is persisting, for Jazeera and structural violence is distributed by identity, it's coagulated in our daily social, economic, and political life. And so one economic example is the way in which our social welfare system implemented in 1996 in South Africa is internationally heralded as being a redistributive mechanism by this systems institution that is so influenced by its past. And this system, the social welfare system, involves cash grants on a monthly basis. And again, it's widely heralded within South Africa and internationally as part of the solution. There is a failure to recognize that this does not redistribute the structures, the factors of production, land, capital, important factors that produce systemic long-term change are not being redistributed. They maintain and remain in the hands of a few. And these are the kinds of, I feel like, structural, we use these phrases and the vagueness, although it's important for that abstractness to be able to have a broad conversation, to be able to specify and call out and have a reckoning of specific examples of how these structural factors persist. You know, I think it's really important in these moments of truth, and I have a few other examples, but I don't want to go over my time perhaps later, we're all talking later. But I really appreciate as well the trauma-informed approach that you spoke about yesterday, Dr. Harden. In my work in early education, I know that this trauma-informed approach is so important, crucially important actually in early childhood, where physiological effects of trauma even precede the structural growth of your brain precedes the later psychological effects. But I would contend that, and I feel daily in my work, that this is dealing with symptoms. And so I just feel that really, I daily feel like structurally we need to be going beyond those systems to the root causes of why the trauma exists, the violence that precedes that trauma. Mm-hmm.
I can follow up next. And it's because I also wanted to thank Professor Harden for talking about, or at least introducing me to the idea of our understanding the trauma approach. And I think that it's something that it's an important question for policy students to consider as they reflect on the lasting impacts that policy can have on how society is organized and how human life and dignity is respected beyond laws, whether they continue to be practiced or whether they become abolished. I think, I know we shouldn't say we, but I'm going to break the rule for a little bit. But I think as policy students, thinking about policy intervention, change in the law, these practices obviously can transform social norms over time, and they do play a role in disrupting violence in political practice. But I think that it's important to remember that even that it is not a given that legal and policy intervention addressing the legacy of political oppression that led to the devaluing of human life and dignity, like those things are not interchangeable, and I think that that's something that has been acknowledged in this conversation. And so thinking about it from the perspective of policy students, repairing the legacies of political oppression is a shared social responsibility, I do believe that, and in particular for people in this room, because while our lives have been shaped in some way by political oppression, we have also navigated through it and have even benefited from the current political structure that continues to deny basic dignity to our friends, to our family members, to people in our increasingly globalized community, whether they are brown, black, transgender, poor, whether they are women here in the United States or south of the border resisting violence. And so my question that I hope that we can think about is how, as policy students, we can, especially folks that have been touched by these oppressions, how we can obviously respect these oppressions and respect our experiences and also sort of understand how we can leverage our current positions, our current power in addressing some of these legacies of oppression.
It's all good. I'm a senior at the Ford School, and over the course of my 4 years here at the University of Michigan, I've seen this institution, students, faculty, just the institution as a whole fail people of color. A few years ago, some of you guys might know, there's a social media movement called Being Black at U of M. And there's a lot of like backlash that happened. Students of color were giving their personal truths about oppression and violence that they faced here at the University of Michigan, and it was faced with a lot of backlash from students saying, oh, people are just, they're just complaining, they just want to have a place to talk. You know, really just shutting down and in that way acting in a violent way by silencing this community. So if my question is, if at the University of Michigan, such a prestigious university, where students can't even express their own narratives and their personal truths, how, as policy students, do we expect to be able to go outside the structure of like the university and allow for people of color to express their own personal narratives and allow themselves to, you know, move up the ladder rather than just continuously being pushed down by people in power?
So my question, or comment, I'm not sure which it is, we'll find a buddy in. It has to do with how people view history and also the social sciences, and this isn't necessarily at a post-secondary level. I also was able to come to U of M for undergrad, and I wrote a persuasive paper for my freshman writing requirement on the need to learn Black history, like as a high school requirement for the state of Michigan. And it had to be workshopped, and one of the comments was that this is racist. And I think everybody, when they reach that critical point where they're learning something new, and after they've kind of digested the information quite a bit, looking back at the past, they think to themselves, how could I not have seen that? So my question is, how can we teach the social sciences better so that we understand history, we understand knowledge as being more fluid than like the suggestion of learning Black history is racist, whereas learning Black history all throughout, like, you know, K through 12 is not.
Um, But I think the first thing I wanted to say is that I appreciate the way that this conversation was framed. One, in the fact of acknowledging the constant presence of violence and how it's recurring in every moment that we're in, but also in the description of the ecological relationship between individuals and institutions and their circumstances. And, you know, kind of going off of Frank's point, you know, we don't talk about in policy spheres how the very tools that we're using were actually initially intended for creating fault lines and for creating divisions and for the oppression of communities of color in this nation's history, right? We don't think about how the rise of statistics in the social sciences correlate with the condemnation of blackness that existed, you know, post-emancipation, right? In the industrial revolution of this country, right? And the thing that I appreciate, too, also from you, Dr. Harden, is the acknowledgement of, paraphrasing your words, but thinking about the way that people engage institutions as being both an individualizing and a collectivizing process. So something where people, it's not only incumbent upon the individual, but also the institutions they're engaging with. And what we fundamentally don't understand is what that engagement is or what that looks like. And so my question then, you know, is first, how can we be better at informing people about the tool, the acknowledging the history of the tools that we're using in everyday practice and educational spheres? But then second, in a more kind of implicating us all, how do we better think about the way that we engage with institutions and acknowledging the experience of others who engage with institutions, particularly when we're making political and economic and social decisions on behalf of others?
So sitting with many things, because many wonderful things have been said, and one of the things that immediately stuck out to me when looking at this abstract and when listening is that is thinking about where these systems are coming from, or how are they being, this machine, how is it running? And as a white person, thinking about my not just legacy of pain, but legacy of violence and harm, and where is my responsibility within that? And so going, instead of, you know, individualistic symptom conversation, how do we get to that macro system root cause conversation more and more, especially at the School of Social Work, I think that's something that we are moving towards, and I wish we could pick up some speed. And the other thing that I also am holding with that is this idea that you were talking about, Professor Harden, of injury with the oppressor. So what does it mean to have been socialized as violent and to be the oppressor in this system, or part of that body? So my question is, how do I, as a white person, take action, so when we are addressing these systems, right, addressing requires action. So how do we do that actively and authentically, and most importantly, in an accountable way? How do I take action in an accountable way? And then also, how do we heal? And also, as a sort of justice practitioner and a keeper of circles, how do we also have circles for healing for those with this injury that we talked about?
Okay, so there's been a lot of wonderful things said, and I'm very appreciative that this event is occurring, that we're able to have this conversation around very many different complex intersections of identity and what's happening around that here. I want to speak to or just give a bit of context from where I'm coming from. I'm a survivor of violence, and I'm also an out queer person. And growing up and where I did, it was very an oppressive situation to be myself. And there were many situations where I had to avoid a violent confrontation as an adult. And what I pursued through my higher education and overcoming many obstacles of being a first generation college student and relying on my own resourcefulness to find my way through to what is guiding me to want to know more, that in the experience of trying to understand yourself in relation to the world, what I've come to know is that there is a kind and gentle way to do that, but I haven't found the best approach, not that I think it would be a universal single opportunity, but to consider that in all that I do, especially recognizing that violent situations, when needing to be interrupted or called out, that is also a moment of needing to acknowledge that who I am communicating with is a human being, regardless of their past or my past. And I see these very separately, but yet they're contained in the macro that we were talking about, in this meta-narrative of, your identity is defined from how it is otherized, and in many different other contextual pieces. But I would like to know how to incorporate the gentleness and the kindness of confronting violence.
One more, unless we're missing.
Oh, no.
Is there more?
No.
No, we're good.
Okay.
So I think that now we have a period where the four of us are going to respond. And something that came up for me as all of you were speaking was the certain power that we all have. And I was thinking about that, the power that I have with my identity and being authentic to that. And I think all of us within this space have some access to privilege. If we didn't, none of us would be here today. And I think that we can all utilize that in different ways. And what came up for me as some of you were talking, especially as we were talking about gender-based violence, there are times where, there's been oftentimes I think of my situation as someone that's been oppressed, has not had access to everything that they could have ever wanted. But there are also times where I can look in the mirror and see the oppressor there, especially as it comes to violence against women or violence against the trans community, because that has been committed by people that look like me and identify like I do. And I understand that with my identity that I'm authentic to, I can have conversations that other people can't, and it will be heard differently. And I think that's something that I think we can all take away in our own circles, with our own identity, is that we can have conversations that not everyone in this room can have. I can have conversations with black men that perhaps Jen might not be able to have. And I think that goes for all of our identities. So just holding that in this space is something that I wanted to say.
Now, tag on to that. So as a former MPP student, I definitely sympathize, and I'm happy to hear all of you so encouraged to address the topics you're talking about. But, like Pete said, I also want to make sure that, and encourage you all to think and remember that, beyond being policy students and graduate students, we're still people. And we're all endowed with some type of privilege, whether we want to own it or not. And so we all have the capacity to invoke and impose some kind of violence. And that's not a bad thing. It's a human thing. But we're not beyond that as policy people. When we go to D.C., we still take these privileges with us. And I think it's important to always consider that you can't fight it, but always acknowledge it, always be mindful of it. In my research, I study absent fathers. I'm cognizant that I'm not studying mothers. And I don't think that's a purposeful privilege or, a purposeful, invoking of that privilege, but it's a privilege I may be exercising nonetheless, and I have to reconcile that. And I think it's important that whatever we do, that we're mindful that we're still people, we still make mistakes, and we still are not going to be perfect, and that we're not going to be absent of privilege. And despite occupying, multiple identities of marginalization, I occupy identities of privilege. And no one's guilty for that, no one's wrong for that. But as policy students, you're not exempt from that. And it's important to acknowledge that along the way.
Anyone else?
A lot is said, and I want to use of space for others to speak that hasn't spoken. So I'll just one issue, please, where I ended with the idea of an extraordinary burden. When I address the concept of extraordinary burden, for me, it's not simply a negative concept. It's not something I carry as bitterly or sadly. It's an acknowledgement that if you have the experience of growing up as being colored, black or brown, or any other color for that matter, that is expressed legally as having a color, that it's not the only fault line of identity that defines me. I mean, I'm defined as male as well. I'm defined in so many other ways as poor. I'm no longer in the same way. And for me, I have a responsibility, both as a classical responsibility, a gendered responsibility, a political responsibility, a racialized or colorized responsibility to live my burden more gently, more carefully, more restoratively. You know? And so for me, the anger should not be expressed in my skin, and it begins there, but it also begins at the point of larger systemic structure and policy. And it's at that nexus, that very complex nexus, that oftentimes gets silenced as too complicated to discuss, or let's just not talk about that now because it's going to be too hard, or it's going to cause too much pain, or there's going to be conflict. And we should have them. I mean, I want to have, and I want to inform and inspire such conversations, and I think I want to acknowledge that even having this conversation in this way, and you know, is part of that interruption, that struggle for finding a more nonviolent, a more gentle way to acknowledge some of the historical questions that exist, sometimes very quietly and sometimes very silently, as norm. Yeah? And one thing that I learned in my own studies and process is that some of those norms are not always conscious. It's easy to run to blame without taking the moment to understand. And for me, as part of my own intellectual process, really pausing and understanding, even if people try to tell me that I'm a person of practice, for me, I do not distinguish between the intellectual project and the project of making the world a less violent place. So structural failures are not failures that have to continue. As students of policy, and I consider myself one as well, I have a responsibility to apprehend where it's failing and direct my efforts to where it might succeed and not fail in the future. But I know that it's not going to be immediate. On my skin or in the future, and that there's no guarantee that I will succeed as a human being apprehended as firstly of color and then secondly as a male of color, and where I come from in my country, oftentimes as a violent, you know, it's oftentimes just violent in that community and that geographic specificity. And so hopefully my sound has changed now from earlier on, because when I present I normally speak like that, but when I'm talking as another human being, I soften up a little bit. So, I'll stop it.
But you soften up, right? What I appreciate about Professor Henry is the both end of what he just said is intellectual rigor and the compassionate heart, right, to this conversation, to this work, right? Somebody mentioned kindness, right? And I think I look at that not from a touchy-feely place, right, but from a serious, accountable compassion, right, and empathy, right? What's the word, radical empathy, that folks use, right, that thinks about the just and connecting with compassion. So I'll start there and just going back to the machinery of what do we do with the process, with the form that we created that was designed to, you know, do a certain thing. Our great Constitution started with many flaws that were amended. And 3/5, right? And even with that, we could make that argument that there's still a question about that in terms of how society values an other, right? A black male's life, a black woman's life, a woman of life of color, right? And so on. And so I think our engagement is in that point of asking real honest questions around, can it be reformed, or does it need to be overthrown and created anew? And I think we are obligated to do that with any of those tools that have been used. And I think that's part of the great democracy we live in, is to be able to do that. So within that, I asked a lot of questions around, you know, some of those things that happened. There's a feminist scholar who said this, and I can't think of her name right now. But she talked about how the question of gender, yes, we have to start talking about boys. What this construction does to boys, right? What happens, right? And that injury that even occurs around living in a highly sexist, patriarchal, right, society does to me, right, to my son. And what policies, principles are in place, right, that reinforce that. And our work with veterans, right, around this issue of moral injury, part of that conversation has to turn to military sexual assault, right, MSA. And how a highly masculinized institution creates that, right, enforces that, which connects us to collegiate sexual assault, right, campus, right, which what happens here, and how this institution or these institutions might also reinforce that, which then again connects us across the board. So then we work to then look at those policies, practices, and procedures, right, that transform and change how that happens, right? And it's a lot of work. And it often takes those of us who sit on the oppressor side to do, but nevertheless, right, engage in that conversation. And I would argue that in some ways it starts with that acknowledgement of injury, right, and how it happens, as well as that injury to even that person in that seat. And so I think therein lies possibility. So I'll stop there. But I think that's where I think about our engagement, our possibilities for restoration, and our possibilities for restorative accountability. Thanks a lot.
So we will now move to general audience questions. And just to remind you, this isn't, you know, again, this don't feel like this is an exhibition. This is just space to talk about how you feel, your reactions, your responses, and any questions you have for anyone on this panel or the panel among you. So please feel free to share.
Sure. So moral injury, a simple way of saying it, when I'm mandated or sanctioned, right, to do something that may go against my moral ethic, right, my understanding, right, and ultimately I see a failure either in that institution or people around me. I might witness something and feel like I don't have any power or control to do anything about it. And so it attacks my sense of who I am in terms of my value, my identity, right? Maybe my faith, maybe my character, maybe my culture. Right? And within that injury, first is the acknowledgement of the injury, but then also what it may mean down the road, right? So in that veteran military context, you know, it might mean that I feel I'm so impacted by shame or guilt or distress that I hurt myself, you know, or I'm unable to reconcile with that peace, right? Some argue that it's a healthy response to war, right? I mean, that's an argument. But nevertheless, it is bringing the question of morality and ethic to this conversation of institutional and structural violence, right? What is a moral ethic in response to X, Y, and Z, police brutality, right? When people, a collective, respond and say, I'm hurt by these particular actions, what is a moral and communal response to that? Is it to say it's not my issue, it's not my pain, or is it a shared responsibility that we take place in being able to do something about it? So.
I'd like to add one dimension, another dimension to what Professor Harden is saying. Oftentimes, there's a question that is posed in very common terms, why, when someone has been victimized, is the act of that process repeated? For example, many groups of people who have been collectively harmed get accused of that in different ways. And for me, that adds a dimension to which is it comes to an injured spirit. When communities and we, well, made up of individuals, are harmed in such a way that even your spiritual, and I don't mean spiritual religiously now, your inner psyche is damaged, is affected in such a way that disrupts the individual first and then the collective ability just for the response. The community becomes, in a sense, paralyzed or constricted and then gets blamed for not being able to resolve their issues, one, or get blamed for the violence that, you know, is endemic and systemic in that space, but is not necessarily embodied in each individual. Yeah. So individual, number of points, individuals then take responsibility and leader who are not broken, who have a different response to that type of social historical policy and sometimes politically induced trauma. So for example, this is an example of that type of response here. For men who have been through it, many people who have spoken that understand what that means and are speaking back as an interruption, but also as a project of daily life, a response to restoration, but not necessarily restoration in the physical sense of a building, but restoring even the spirit that is, you know, that can be broken through a violent impact. Whether you, and this doesn't mean that any particular group of people can be so essentialized. I mean, anybody can commit violence, anybody can experience it. The conversation is not simply black or white, which is hopefully something that I've heard from this group and what I would like to reiterate. In terms of this idea of a, you know, of a spirit, of an injury to the spirit, of the spirituality, the moral fabric of society.
I think about the term "I can't breathe," right, and that has multiple meanings, right? You know, there's the statement, Eric Garner, the political piece of that, but it's also the collective, you know, capturing of that moment of injury, you know, and breath and the spirit injury associated with that. So I can't breathe means more than just the literal or the figurative piece of that. So how do we engage collectively and take a breath, right?
And I'll end one sentence. How do we find the restorative language of accountability?
So I'm really interested in the idea of empathy, and I know in the professor in this class we talk a lot about different types of empathy. So between oppressor and the oppressed, and just kind of at the story at large, I was interested if you could talk about how empathy plays a role in the trauma-informed work you've done, or kind of just in this conversation at large.
I think it's inherent in that work. I think it's inherent in the restorative work that happens in circle keeping. I think it's a powerful place where that occurs because it allows for this deeper voice and engagement. It also gives me permission to take a little bit of the professional lens off for a second and be human, you know, within that. And so part of our work is to as we get our titles and earn our degrees and get the letters behind and front of our name, all this kind of stuff. It's how do I still engage the human within that? And when I'm in those spaces of just a couple of days ago sitting with the head of probation, juvenile probation, and sitting with the state's attorney's office, and it's, you know, how do we still engage that human? How do we invite others to see, as I mentioned yesterday, things big as well as things small, right? Friend and colleague, former deputy commissioner with the city of Chicago, Azeem Ramalis, says that, you know, we need to, you know, everything that we can count doesn't count always, right? And some of the things that we can't count counts, right? And so how do we engage in those discussions to bring out some of these other voices and that work? So I think that's where that empathy, you know, comes in.
If I may piggyback off of that, something that Mo brought up, the gentlewoman next to her, as well as the gentleman right there, and Pete, is the privilege or the lack of privilege intersecting gender and race. And something that's really helped me become a better person and more empathetic is realizing that while my skin color may not be a privilege, my gender is. And I was thinking in terms of, along the lines of that gentleman was saying over there, is growing up K through 12, I think a trauma that I'm surviving and overcoming that isn't addressed in education is seeing images of myself that are smart and positive that aren't associated with slavery. You may not know this, but Katherine Johnson is a great mathematician who was a black woman who programmed the trajectory for the initial moon landing. And my niece doesn't know that, who is a black woman. I don't know that, and other races outside of my own don't know. So I think part of empathy that's beautiful is you can see, not only do I not have a lot of images of a black man, women don't have images of themselves, period. Look at the dollar bill, Alexander the Great, Einstein, just the mainstream conscious of thought leader fits a very certain dichotomy or a very certain image. So I think empathy allows you to look outside of yourself so you can understand yourself better. So trying to look through the lens of a woman in recent months and weeks has been very, very beneficial. And I think that's the power that empathy has.
Which has been, and this might be controversial here in Michigan, but which has been interesting looking at and watching whatever side of the fence you stand on, kind of the vitriol towards Hillary Clinton, right? There's a certain meanness that I wonder, is it rooted in something related to this gender construction that we have in our world? Just a thought.
Yes. You saw it.
Yeah.
So coming off of this idea of empathy, and then something you had said earlier, how do we take a collective breath? Actually, coming off of everything that I've just heard, two things are standing out to me right now, and one is time, and another is and I don't mean to be flippant about the use of violence-ness, but the learning process and how it can feel sometimes violent, how it can really shake people to the core to learn something new. And as an educator, I wrestle with that, specifically with, I think, something you said about how somebody responded to your paper and said, well, but that's racist. And I started thinking about, you said, how do we teach this better? And I thought some of that is a function of time, given that wherever that person is in their learning journey, it's clearly not where that perhaps they need to be with awareness, but how do we meet everyone sort of where they are? And how do you do it in a way that's not harmful? And I'm not totally sure that harm can be without, that we can teach in a way that doesn't harm. Maybe we can follow this kinder and gentler way, but when I think about my own learning processes and the times that I've had to step back and say, whoa, oh, okay, there's this thing called whiteness, and I'm from Georgia as well, so race is in your face, southern Georgia, not Atlanta. So it's like in your face a lot. Highly, highly segregated. So the idea that I had to go through all of these experiences to get to where I am today, and some of that is a function of time. So how can I expect people who didn't live like what I did kind of have the same knowledge and experiences, but yet I can't accept that people who don't have that can continue to harm so many people. And I guess I'm struggling with it, I guess there's some hope as well that I think it's a collective struggle. And I really appreciate the spaces like this because through dialogue and being able to talk to each other and listen to each other, which I've never heard listen nonviolently, but that's a really, I really am going to sit with that. But to hear what people are saying, I think that that should be embedded in all that we do, but it takes time. And in policy specifically, we often ask, I'm in the School of Education, but I'm doing historical things, and we say, well, why don't we have historians at the table with policymakers? And I wonder, it's the functions of policy, how quickly and rapidly it moves, what we miss when we don't have what Tamar sort of brought up, like a real historical understanding of how those tools have been used. So I don't want to be taking up lots of space. There's just a lot of stuff going on up here.
There are two things. One thing that contributes to the conversation, and another that's procedural. So I think I'll start with the former. And I think the idea of transgenerational trace I want to introduce as well to this concept of not only radical empathy, but also to understanding pain, trauma, even violence as part of the human condition. It is textured into our self and corporal construct. It's not simply a categorical conversation. It has been with us for a long time as people. We construct the idea of living life only with privilege, meaning everything is fine, there's no discomfort, is something that was new. My whole life was the word privilege did not even exist as an English word. So, in that sense, when one speaks to the question of policy and history, and as it relates to transgenerational identity trace, it is not accidental that one identity category can procedurally mark its history, whilst at the same time other identities at sea. Yeah, I'm trying to find, where is it? How do I get to this place as a human being, and why is it that I cannot see myself in how this time looks like? And this is a struggle that is, it's an issue that has been conversed. W. Du Bois spoke about it. I mean, Césaire spoke about, I mean, every time when there's been a generation making history looking for the language, this issue has occurred. And so it's important to think of that as part of the policymaking process, the historical process, meaning not history in the discipline narrowly, but history in the making. As we sit here, as we breathe here, and I had to think about that as a young man very carefully, because it was very easy to get lost in all the pain of being victimized and becoming part of a painful society. Yeah, and to disrupt, to remove myself from that as a thinker, whilst realizing that I can't remove myself, that it's happening at the same time, all the time. So, for me, those being able to it took a long time, and I had to read maybe 4,000 testimonies to violence when I was working at the South African Truth and Reconciliation Commission, to understand that, oh my God, the actual victims of this process were, you know, the families and the mothers and the children, not those who were participating in making the historical moment. And it took me a long time reading, editing those stories that testify to loss, to understand that, oh my God, these people testifying to loss actually are the real survivors of the violence. And it allowed me to begin to think how and what do I do as a survivor to contribute to that restorative process, because as long as their voices, their sounds, their names are unheard, there can be no accounting for that experience, no accountability. And as long as it is not an accounting, where is the restorative policy frame going to come from? So that's the one point I want to make. The second point is procedural, and we've been discussing it because we are 20 minutes. We've taken Michigan 10 minutes time, and we know that we are over time. So if those of you that would like to stay and continue this conversation, you are welcome. And anybody that you know doesn't want to stay, that's okay. That's it. You're also welcome, you know, we will not take offense, I would, with your permission, Matthew and Pete, allow for concluding statements either from anybody here, just very quick sentences to conclude and to lead us to conclusion, because that's also part of the restorative circle process, And this circle that we've made here is a concentric restorative circle. Yeah. There's a single circle in the middle, and then it ripples literally outward. Yeah. So it stands as a monument, as a memorial to this idea when you drop, what is it called, the ripple effect? Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's supposed to be funny, but you know I'm not so funny. When you drop the pebble into an ocean and it ripples out, we are embodying the ripple, and hopefully this conversation will not end here. So I want to allow everybody, just quickly, a quick conclusive sentence, a statement, even if it's one word, and then anybody, but to start with anybody from the audience, if you want to just say something very quickly, please. I'm not going to leave this chair until the last person who decides to stay here outside of the regulated Michigan time that we've taken back. There's no law. The law has not passed. You know, winter time is not, you know, hasn't been rescinded yet. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So I'm going to give a hand back to Pete and Matt and the external moderation, and then we'll conclude.
All right.
It is my sincere hope that this is just the beginning of further conversations here at the Ford School that are much needed, and they've been ongoing, and I think it's our responsibility to make sure that we continue.
More of a last question than a comment. I'm really intrigued by the way in which you've been talking about trauma and identifying it and saying that people are experiencing it. But I think there's something really intricate about the way in which we identify and see trauma as being there. And I say that as a person who studies father and a person who thinks about, I think, just traumas in general, that I say that when I study absent fatherhood, that, and as someone who comes from an absent father background, with many peers who had absent fathers, that sometimes I feel like when everyone has the same problem, no one has a problem. And how do you get people to understand and engage and deal with their trauma if they don't see it as such? And what can we say about then in our efforts as policymakers, as academics, as social workers, that work of getting people to maybe be aware of pain, of suffering, but also not imposing our sense of pain and suffering on them. You know, who am I to tell someone that not having your father is a bad thing? But at the same time, if it's normal for you, you'll never see it as bad in the first place, right? So it's more of a question about this idea of trauma and it being normal and how we think about the ways to engage it. Not just those suffering from it, but also the way in which we impose the idea of it.
One thing that I'm sort of thinking through from this conversation is how meta-narratives of violence also exist in relation to constructions of the ideal. And so as something to consider for myself, as I move through the world, to consider how confronting meta-narratives or becoming aware of meta-narratives of what success looks like or what ideals look like institutionally and professionally as a social, you know, someone who has studied social work and is working through what that identity means, to be able to kind of also look at narratives of success and ideal in relationship to violence and how they might be violent in their relationship.
I'll throw in, I get drawn in every time by these titles that say space and think that we're gonna talk about like places. And so I really appreciated a comment that you made about bad places, you know, or how places get termed as being sort of holding the potential for violence, essentially, I think. Sorry, this is not a question, this is a comment. But I'm sitting here trying to think about how the discussion today, I hear violence very much as an idea of an embodied encounter with structures. But then trying to think about how are structures and systems embodied otherwise, right? Like, I think violence is like it's one singular individual. Take that back, sorry. But I'm pondering also these questions of ideals and of norms and the bad places are places where there is some sort of a deviation from norm, right? But like, that when I talk about a space in an abstract sense, that might be kind of safe. That we're talking where there isn't a friction between the structure of that space and what's happening in that space, mm-hmm. and that then we have other places, right, that get turned or colored because there is some sort of friction or deviation between this like unremarkable normal state and what is actually embodied and present.
I have been struck by the conversation around kindness and gentleness, and especially as it relates to kind of privileged frailty. I don't know if there's like a better way to put it, right? But that the first times I, as a white person, started learning about whiteness, I probably experienced like white frailty. That like everyone had to be really gentle with me because if they were just truthful and blatant and honest, I would perceive it as harm and it would shut down my ability to keep moving forward as a white person in my own growth. In a similar way that when I talk to straight people and cisgender people about queer stuff, it's like, I'm a starter queer, right? Like, let me introduce you to the concept of people who are not straight and who are not cisgender, and let me do it very gently. And as a pastor, right, like, part of that is like, let me be very pastoral with you and just listen a lot while you talk about things that also are causing me harm to listen to you, but you need somebody to listen and it has to be somebody who's going to take you like baby steps. So I'm just like, I just want to like, I don't know, hold that or of, I don't know if it's possible to not do harm or at least like perceived harm and how we experience that.
Just to respond to that, I think that's a really good point you make, and you know, having that sense of, you know, people aren't coming necessarily from a place of malice, but more so a place of ignorance, and like your role in like educating them of what it's like, you know, to have someone experience it. I think again, to the point of knowing that what they might be saying causes harm, I think it needs again like a lot of exploration of your own self to know what triggers you, what doesn't, and like how you're gonna be able to separate those emotions and how you're going to be able to move any conversation forward. Because if any comment that someone says that's ignorant triggers you to have a violent response or just to shut down and tell them that they're idiots or something like that, right? It's not going to be conducive to anything. So I think that's, I like what you said because it resonates with that idea I have that it's important to be very self-aware if you're truly trying to work toward having social change in any environment that needs it.
I think a lot of points that were brought up today were just powerful in general, and just from the previous two comments that were shared in the space, I think moving forward, when I think about restorative justice, I'm always thinking about the coping mechanism. Because for me, in my life, I had to cope by myself. To be called white, cope with it by yourself at a predominantly black high school. To be called a slave by a tenured professor in class in front of everyone 3 times, to cope with that by yourself. To be called nappy-headed, to be called all those things that can trigger. And I think about when I'm being kind and gentle, to explain to people those moments and tell them this is not out of harm, this is not out of violence. And that when I say the word black or race, don't close up just yet. But at the same time, understanding that this conversation requires coping. And where does that start? And where does that begin? And where does that end? Is there a middle? Do you have to cope by yourself? Can you cope by yourself? What do you use to cope?
Now I would make my concluding comment. I mean, there obviously will be many questions, and when I sent out a message, I was like, our aim today is not to resolve every question, at least to pose them and to begin to engage some. So for me, I'm normally very abstract and intellectual, and I'll try to be less so. I have struggled to cope as well. And I think when one experiences bodily as well as physical, repetitive, experiential trauma, as social but also as physical, because for me words are not, words are active as well. They are physical. We cannot see them. But somewhere in the mind, in the ear, they are being received and translated in an organismic way, yeah, and then reiterated into the physical, extra-psychic world that I inhabit and we as human beings inhabit. And so coping, it's important to distinguish between holding a space like this and coping with it. I don't want to conflate us producing a space together as a restorative space, even as a hard and a difficult space. I mean, some people call it brave. I mean, I want to not go simply to brave, yeah, because brave and courageous is, can live together, and every word, even if it's gentle, gentle and kind, doesn't mean without power for me. Yeah? And I, as coming from where I come, if I did not learn to cope with what happened to my community, to the community as I live now, that continues to happen, and many of you that are here have been to South Africa as well. So if I did not learn that language of coping, then I would not be sitting here alive today as a survivor, taking this issue of structure and violence and restorative accountability seriously. Now I live the language of that, but I also remember the language of those who are less fortunate, who did not make it here. And when I say here, I don't mean the Ford School in the seat, who did not make it here to breathe. To go back to this idea of I cannot breathe. Now, it's important not to conflate holding a brave space with encountering terror. They're not the same. And it's very important to make that conceptual distinction for me as someone who has seen that in the world. And if I go home, see it from the minute I get, I leave the airport to when I get into my front door, and it never goes away. Because that's been internalized, and I can see it. So I think that part of creating these spaces and these dialogic possibilities is crucial if we are going to learn to cope together. Because as part of what Professor Harden said yesterday, and I would agree with him completely, is that I cannot, and I would not, and I don't think you can, anyone can come to cope with that type of trauma alone. Yeah, it is done communally. The restorative bond, the restorative relationship is co-structured, always. Yeah? When that isolation takes effect, and I have buried at least 25 men in the last 10 years, I've been to their funerals who I grew up with, which is extraordinary. Yeah? I never speak about it publicly because of the same point that you make, it's too much for the public space. And I've learned to be gentle and slow, because I know why I exist as an intellectual. I project myself into the future, into a restorative future. Yeah, and so for that I have to cope. And I know it, and unfortunately, and I've said this to, and I say this to others as well, even with, you know, is that unfortunately, it's unfortunately. Doesn't make any difference. I still have to cope with it, and I plan to because I care about where I come from and the people who I've left behind, and to, you know, as an intellectual responsibility. So yeah, so in that sense, I mean restorative, yeah, accountability, coping, and when we do so collectively like this, for me, it is an act of disruption. Yeah, hopefully we can, if we can listen nonviolently, hold each other bravely and powerfully, then we are beginning to live a possibility, the hope of peace, really, just here, right now.
I'm thinking about the word coping, right? I'm thinking about the word violence. I'm taking those away. And I'm thinking about, so there's that term that we use in social work, vicarious trauma, right? So when we listen and hear those stories, that we see, it's, you know, we take them home, and suddenly I realize that I'm having something, some symptoms, because I've taken all that in, right? And how much can the human being take in those stories of pain and suffering without feeling something, being something that is inherently human, even within the professional and licensed and clinical context? So it's real. So how do I take care, and how do I build solidarity with people in community to be around that? And that probably arguably is one of the first searches, right? Is finding that community that that is of others, you know, who I can be with a common language, a common understanding, and who can hold me within that, black, white, whatever, right? in the beginning it was black men, black women. Now it's multiracial, ethnic, gender, you know, sexuality, all the above, right? You know, because we all share in this space, right? That collective. But part of it is finding that. And so I was thinking about the fragility question, right? Because I think it's very real, you know, in the face of, certainly I've dealt with that in the beginning, and talking and having these conversations, you know, I would be really okay with somebody being very upset, right? You know, and okay, deal with the struggle, right? You know, it's part of the work, right? and dealing with men and ego, right? You know, this whole piece. So, you know, and over time, you know, taking on that, what does gentle mean? And then in leadership, right? Creating the space to kind of hold that comes up. You know, fragility across the board, right? Not just from a white space, but also even for a person of color to be vulnerable and risk re-victimization and re-traumatization within those spaces, because that is often the unspoken thing that happens when those conversations happen, right? You know, as a person walks out. So how do we structure allies and points of solidarity as we do the work? You know, expecting that harm may occur, right? And that if I follow the mantra of do no harm or leave a space better than it was that I walked in, then what is my obligation and responsibility to that? And I think that's where I think about these spaces, but also even institutionally, right? You know, how we set that solidarity up. You know? There's some practical pieces that I won't get into around doing that, thinking about that, but I think that that's a very real piece. So I'll just say this and be quiet. Is that I'm thinking about disruptive technology, right? You know, that's the business part, right? And that this is that technology in this world, right, that we move in. And so that is what I invite this space and the people leaving here is to consider what might be the disruptive technology and the policy framework, right, that creates this transformation in our world and equity in our world. And I just want to also just really lift up those of you and my comrades in this conversation as this moment of inspiration and this moment of truth that we share here, that I truly plan to take this concentric circle back to Chicago and beyond. Thank you.
So we're gonna wind down in the spirit of time. Before I offer some acknowledgements and thanks, I want to give Pete a chance to say anything.
I'm good.
I want to first say that, I want to thank Yazier. In the 10 years I've been here on and off as an MPP and a PhD student, you know, I'm very happy to see, in the spirit of disrupting, Yazier disrupt a norm that 10 years ago we would not have had a conversation like this, where people could talk about suffering and coping and all the components of the fragile human spirit. Conversations that would have normally taken place in Yazir's office, in the bathroom, at home, you know, crying to your friends, like, can be had in this kind of space. And I want to thank Yazir for advancing that in the time that I've been here. Left and came back. But with that, I also want to thank Dean Collins for encouraging such a discussion over that time. That, you know, when she came 10 years ago, this was a space that this could not have happened, and now it can. And I want to thank both of you for encouraging that effort. And I encourage you all to also keep this conversation going. I mean, we're all human, like I said, and we all suffer. We all have feelings. Engage those. You know, don't forget that, you know, beyond your discipline, you know, you're human beings. And it's important to remember that, and that's all we can be, but we can acknowledge that in our day-to-day with the people we're not with. So I'll pass it on to Dr. Harden as to make any final comments, but I also just want to, again, acknowledge and thank you all for participating in this discussion.
Can we give it up for our two moderators? I'll just say this real quick, one quick sentence. I want to acknowledge my ancestors, our ancestors, right? Who showed the pathway to coping. And in through resistance and collective struggle, right? The healing and restorative process. Right? So if we look to history, we might find some of our answers.
Ashe.
Ashe.
And I want to acknowledge those of you in the complete first circle, that it's not the easiest position that, you know, in this conversation. So I want to thank you for being courageous and joining myself, Troy, Keith, and Nat in completing this conversation. And thank everyone else who came and sat for an extra half hour in this space. And I want to acknowledge that oftentimes that's not usual, but it's hopefully something that stands as an example of what is possible and what we can do in this moment, and hopefully that it will translate itself as we leave as experts and leaders and thinkers. So thank you very much. I understand that the conversation is not complete. It cannot be completed. It has to be, in my opinion, ongoing. Completed and recompleted, developed and redeveloped if necessary. So thank you very much for making this possible and for spending this time and putting in the effort that you have as thinkers and human beings who've experienced some of the traumas that we're talking about as identified in so many different ways. Women, men, black and white, brown and red, pink, and all sorts of other things. At some point it is my responsibility, and I've learned this, to transcend all of those things and find, you know, my ability to see another human being and to talk to them. So thank you very much for engaging me in this dialogue and, you know, allowing me to take what Dean Collins has also created, to create the possibility where we can talk to each other as human beings in this space. So thank you. That's it.